Professor Dave here. Let's talk about limits.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
The development of calculus arose from discussing limits. We defined some activity and allowed a parameter to either increase to infinity, like the number of sides in a polygon, or decrease to zero, like the amount of time elapsed between two positions, so that we could see what happens as we approach that value. But the use of limits has been largely replaced by a more modern framework, and we will be operating out of that framework as we learn about derivatives and integrals. However, there are select moments where we will be using limits, and we need to understand what they mean and how to manipulate them. So before moving forward, let's talk a little bit about limits and the laws associated with them. Quite simply, we can look at some function and describe a limit of that function as x approaches some value. If we have f of x equals x squared, and we want to find the limit as x approaches 2, that will simply be 4. Whether we approach from the negative direction or the positive direction, as we get closer and closer to an x value of 2, we get closer and closer to a value of 4 for the function. So the limit of f of x as x approaches 2 equals 4. One might wonder why we don't simply evaluate the function at x equals 2 and get 4. This is a totally valid question, and in this example, there is no difference. That's because this is a continuous function. The limit of the function as x approaches a is f of a. But some functions have vertical asymptotes, and we will want to know what a function does as it approaches that asymptote from either side. But we can't just plug in the value where the asymptote occurs, as for that input, the function will be undefined. In other cases, perhaps there is no asymptote, but there is a point discontinuity. Let's remove the point 2, 4 from our previous example. Now, what we've described about the limit of the function as x approaches 2 is no different than what we had before, even though the function no longer equals 4 at x equals 2. This is because the function still does the same thing as we approach 2 from either direction. Similarly, we may want to know about the end behavior of a function as x proceeds infinitely in either direction. And it may not always be obvious from looking at the function in equation form. So this is the realm where limits have their application. Say we are now looking at the function x minus 1 over x squared minus 1. As we may recall from algebra, this denominator can be factored, and then this x minus 1 term can cancel. So this function will look exactly like 1 over x plus 1, which we can graph quite easily. But there is one difference. The original function must have a discontinuity at x equals 1, because the denominator is 0 when x equals 1, which makes the function undefined. This is an example where limits become useful, because we want to know what the function does all the way up until we get to 1 from either side, and we can't just plug the value directly into the function like we could with the x squared function. Instead, we can plug in values that get closer and closer to 1, both larger and smaller, and we can clearly see that the function approaches 0.5, or 1/2. So that's the limit of this function as x approaches 1. Even if we change this function so that at precisely x equals 1, we give the function some other value, like 2, that won't change the limit, because the limit doesn't look at what the function is doing at that point, only what it is doing while approaching that point. And the behavior of the function everywhere else has remained the same. Let's look at something that would be a little tougher to graph. Take something like sine of x over x. What is the value of this function as x approaches 0 from either direction? Well, let's plug in some numbers. Now, we can't just plug in 0, because the sine of zero is zero, and the denominator would also be zero. Having 0/0 is a big problem because we have no idea what the function is doing at this point from this information alone. It could be doing anything. Instead, let's plug in values approaching zero from either direction, and we will see that the function is approaching 1. So the limit of this function as x approaches 0 is 1. This is an impressive achievement because using limits, we are able to see that something that initially looked like 0/0 was actually equal to 1. So we ought to see the utility of this method. Let's also point out that the limit of a function may depend on the direction one is moving. Take this function, which is defined to be equal to 0 if x is less than 0, and equal to 1 if x is greater than or equal to 0. What is the limit of this function as x approaches 0? Well, we get a different value if we are coming at 0 from the positive side or negative side, so there is no limit at this value. But we can instead describe two different one-sided limits. The limit of f of x as x approaches 0 from the negative side, which is indicated by a negative sign in superscript over the 0, is 0. We are getting closer and closer to 0, or rather in this case the function remains at 0. The limit of f of x as x approaches 0 from the positive side, which is indicated by a positive sign in superscript over the 0, is 1. We are getting closer and closer to 1, or again, in this case, the function remains at 1. These are called left-hand and right-hand limits. Now, what about manipulating limits algebraically? This can be done, and there are some important laws that we can learn. First, the limit of a sum of functions is equal to the sum of the limits. This should sound reasonable, as if one function approaches 6 and another approaches 5, then the sum of these functions should approach 11, which is the sum of the individual limits. As obvious as this sounds, it's important to make careful sense of these things. So the limit of a sum is equal to the sum of limits. The same goes for the limit of a difference. We just switch the sign. We can also do the same thing for the limit of a product of functions, as well as a quotient, provided that the bottom limit does not equal 0. And lastly, the limit of a constant times a function equals the constant times the limit. So we could look at two functions on the coordinate plane and describe particular limits at key points, such as points with discontinuities. We already know how to find these limits for an individual function, so this application is no different. We are just doing algebra with limits. If we can find the limit of each separate function as it approaches 2, then we can find the limit of f of x plus g of x as x approaches 2, or f of x minus 3g of x, or f of x times g of x, or f of x over g of x. To these laws, we can add just a couple more, all of which require that n be a positive integer. The limit of a function raised to some power, n, is equal to the limit raised to that power. Similarly, the limit of some nth root of a function is equal to that root of the limit. The limit of x to the n as x approaches a is a to the n. And the limit of the nth root of x as x approaches a is the nth root of a. And the last two laws we will mention, the limit of a constant is equal to that constant regardless of the parameters of the limit, and the limit of x as x approaches a particular value is that value. That seems like a lot of laws, but they come in very handy when trying to assess the limit of a more complex function. Take something like x cubed plus 2x squared minus 1 over 5 minus 3x. Say we want to find the limit of this function as x approaches negative 2. Now that we have these laws, we don't have to graph the function and inspect it visually, as that would take a while. Instead, let's apply the laws. We have a quotient, so we can just evaluate the limit of the numerator and the limit of the denominator separately, because of the law we know regarding quotients. Furthermore, we can split each of those up into individual terms because of the laws regarding sums and differences. And lastly, any constants operating on variables can be pulled outside of the limit because of the law we know regarding constants. We may be left with lots of limits, but all of them are easy to evaluate. For x cubed, we get negative 8. For x squared, we get 4. Times 2 is 8. And 1 is a constant, so that remains 1. On the bottom, 5 remains 5. And x is negative 2. Times 3 is negative 6. So after doing some arithmetic, we end up with negative 1/11. Now, it is true that in this case, we could have just evaluated the function at x equals negative 2 to get this answer. But this won't always be the case, so we should get used to using limit laws in this manner. Furthermore, we may also have to do some algebra to an expression first in order to be able to use the limit laws, which may involve canceling terms or some other manipulation. So with that, we have a reasonable idea of what limits are and how to calculate them. We will continue to see limits from time to time, but we will now switch gears a bit in order to understand differentiation outside of the context of limits. So let's move forward and learn about derivatives. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.